So the approach that we take at ICAP is actually, you can see it on this slide. It's a focus on access, it's a focus on acceptability, it's a focus on quality, it's a focus on coverage, and a focus on effectiveness. So I call this ACE, acronym is ACE, with quality at the very center. Let's talk about access and how this was achieved in terms of the HIV response. I showed you before the state of the health facility. So what needed to happen was a transformation. And part of our work has been to take clinics that look like that and transform them to vibrant clinics that look like this. Places where people could be treated with respect, where there are facilities that can take care of them, where there could be privacy and resources that are available to provide them with what they needed. It meant having to take a clinic that looked like this, a laboratory that looked like this, and transform it to a laboratory that looked like that. This was all possible, and this is what had to be accomplished. It also meant that the system had to be transformed into a continuity care system. For most people around the world, they only seek health care when they're very sick. And they go and they get care for whatever ails them that day, and that's the end of the story. And there was a fundamental need to transform the thinking of the healthcare system itself, as well as the thinking of the people themselves, that it is about continuity care and it's not about episodic care. This meant establishing a system with appointment systems, with medical records that did not exist, with a staff that's devoted to data management and data quality, and also then to use the data to guide the target setting and to guide the quality of the program itself. This meant establishing laboratory and drug procurement systems. You can see here support for national laboratories, specimen support, medication procurement, and quality assurance. Another challenge is the workforce. If you remember the building blocks. It's very important to have sufficient workforce, skilled workforce, in order to be able to achieve access. In this figure from a study from 2004, you can see here the direct relationship between mortality and the health worker density. And it's very obvious that with increase in healthcare worker density, you can see a decrease, association with decrease in under 5 child mortality, a decrease in infant mortality, and a decrease in maternal mortality. Now, what is the situation globally? The situation globally is quite distressing. If you look at the United States, for example, where HIV prevalence is about 0.6%, we have a density of about 550 physicians per 100,000. If you contrast that with a country like Lesotho, where ICAP works, HIV prevalence is 29%, and they have a physician prevalence of 5 per 100,000. If you look at Ethiopia, a huge country, with low HIV prevalence, but nonetheless a huge number of people living with HIV, you see again 3 physicians per 100,000. So that was a challenge. How does one respond to the paucity of healthcare workers and the disparity in distribution of these healthcare workers? Another way of looking at the situation in Africa is to look actually in a similar manner to these maps at the distribution of physicians. And when you map the continents, the proportion of physicians available globally, you can see here Africa almost disappears off the map. In proportion, of course, to the United States, Western Europe, or parts of Asia. If you look at nurses, it's the same situation. Nurses are the backbone of the healthcare system. You can see again that almost the continent almost disappears. Very few nurses to provide the needs for the populations. And if you look at midwives, very important for maternal health and for child health, again, you'll see that in most countries in sub-Saharan Africa, very few of the midwives that are necessary to provide the services. So what did we have to do? I think what we had to do is to support the training and mentorship, and you can see here the cadres of workers that are being had to be trained to be able to provide this work. And another aspect of the training that was really fundamental was the training of multidisciplinary teams to establish a new culture that says that the physician cannot do it by himself or herself, that you needed a team in order to deliver quality services. And another very important principle was supporting task shifting and task sharing. And by that we mean that rather than depending on the very few physicians, which would be impossible to achieve any of the goals of these programs. One had to think carefully about what are the tasks that can be shared by other cadres of the workforce. What can nurses do that doctors need not do? What do outreach and outreach workers do that nurses don't need to do, et cetera, et cetera. And this has been successfully done in many of the countries where we work. So let's move on to acceptability, an important goal of these programs. One of the most important things to achieve acceptability was to provide comprehensive care. What we all know is people demand and look for care that responds to all their needs. And this means that we had to respond to the clinical needs as well as to the psychosocial needs, particularly, for example, focusing on adherence, utilizing all the tools at our fingertips. In order to achieve acceptance, we also had to garner community support and community governance. And this is an area where HIV was quite innovative in that it actually garnered the mapping and the inclusion of community resources to be able to respond to the epidemic. Mapping of community resources was done, engagement of community leaders and key stakeholders in investing in the programs and believing that it is theirs, theirs to shape and theirs to keep. Support of community-based organizations and particularly organizations of people living with HIV, and then establishment of a whole new model for governance that includes the people themselves who are affected. One of the innovations in HIV is for the first time, people living with HIV, people with the disease itself, had a voice. They were very important. They were at the table shaping the programs and demanding the quality of the services that they needed. Let's move on to quality, which I believe, as I told you, is at the center of any of the programs. I'll start by talking to you a bit about the HIV cascade. One of the important things in shaping HIV programs is you have to go out and look for people. And HIV testing is the backbone of any HIV program. For people who are found to be HIV positive, it's very important to link them to the services. And then if they're linked to the services, they need to be engaged, counseled, monitored, and supported, even if they don't need antiretroviral therapy. And then when they become eligible for treatment or antiretroviral therapy eligible, then they need to again be retained and counseled and monitored and supported. And the goal of this, of course, is to achieve the optimal outcomes for them through adherence and suppression of the amount of virus in their blood. So this is the HIV cascade. And unfortunately, there are many leaks in the HIV cascade. These are some examples that I'll show you. This is the HIV cascade from Mozambique, another country where ICAP works. This is work by colleagues of ours who work in Mozambique. So in this one example, there were 23,000 people who were tested with HIV, for HIV. 7,000 were found to be HIV positive, about 30% HIV prevalence, pretty high. Continue the cascade. Of those, about half of them only enrolled in HIV care within 30 days. That's a big leak in the cascade right there and then. About 77% of those got a CD4 test, very important for staging and determining antiretroviral therapy eligibility. Only half, actually, of those who were eligible initiated antiretroviral therapy. And of those who actually initiated antiretroviral therapy, a very small proportion were adherent to treatment. So this is an important aspect of the quality of the programs, and this is very critical, the cascade of care. This is relevant to any condition you can think of, the importance of diagnosis, but beyond diagnosis, the importance of keeping people in care so they have access to the interventions that you have for them. And in one big, large study that looked at 29 studies, actually, from sub-Saharan Africa, you can actually see in this cascade that of 100 people living with HIV, on average, only about 25% or 25 of them would have initiated antiretroviral therapy appropriately. So these are the challenges that HIV faced. Now, lest you think that this is a problem in Africa, let's look at the United States. So if you look at the United States, we see we have the same challenge. As I told you, it's estimated 1.1 million people living with HIV. Only about 80% know that they're HIV infected. The rest are, they don't know that they have HIV. And out of them, about 77% of those are linked. Of those, 77% are linked to HIV care. And you can see what happens to the cascade as we go down and down. This is the inefficiency in programs. So of all the HIV infections in the United States, 85, which is 1.1, estimated 1.1 million, 850,000 individuals don't have suppressed viral load, actually. So the majority of people in the United States are not achieving optimal outcome. So we have also issues with the cascade. Why is this important? This is important for quality, measuring quality of programs. Now, why are the reasons for this? There are many reasons for not knowing your HIV status, and I don't have to go through them, all of these reasons. People are unaware, they're at risk, they're afraid to get tested, they have great fear of stigma, for example. There's late diagnosis of HIV because testing is not accessible. There's a failure of people with HIV to link, again, because of fear, stigma, mistrust of the healthcare system, unaware of the importance of HIV. There's late initiation of antiretroviral therapy because of limited access or waiting lists, limited treatment literacy, and many other reasons. And then inability to achieve viral suppression because of barriers to adherence, whether it be substance use, homelessness, mental illness, or many, many other impediments. So what have we been able to do to try to tackle this? Part of this has been to think outside the healthcare facility, to think of beyond the walls of clinics, and to utilize our most powerful resource that is often right there and then. And that's people living with HIV themselves, what are called peer educators. These peer educators are engaged in providing training, outreach, and supporting each other so that people living with HIV can remain in programs and can garner the benefits from available interventions. Let's talk about coverage. What do I mean by coverage? A very important goal in order for us to achieve optimal program outcomes. By coverage, I mean reaching all the people who we need to reach, men and women in the context of HIV, men, women, children, young and old, disenfranchised and marginalized populations. Often in many countries, it could be men who have sex with men or injection drug users or female sex workers, urban and rural peoples, the rich and the poor. And it's absolutely critical to achieve coverage in order to achieve optimal program outcomes. So one of the approaches we took is focusing on family focus to try to reach, provide the services for the whole family together rather than fracturing the programs for the adults versus the programs. Another innovation has been, just one example, is inclusion and involvement of men. Believe it or not, men are often forgotten. They underutilize the healthcare services all over the world, including in the United States. And this is just an example of one program. We took the men, the partners of pregnant women, and they went through a course and got training to be able to support their wife during pregnancy and beyond. And you can see here the joy when they received their certificates upon graduation from the program. And also, for the first time, I was there during the ceremony, for the first time ever, you see this gentleman here carrying his baby. So this is the kind of engagement of populations that are hard to reach. Another aspect of the work has been to try to reach people in remote areas. You can't focus on centers of excellence. Simply, centers of excellence in large capital cities are seductive, they're beautiful, they're often where excellent care is provided. But if you want to achieve coverage, you have to reach people where people are at. This means decentralization, going to remote areas. And this gives you a sense of the work that we have been doing. This is in Kenya as an example. In 2008, there was support for 68 facilities to provide these services. In 2010, there were 101 facilities providing the services. And you can see here now, in 2012, there are 859 facilities providing these sites that are providing the services. This is important for equity, and this is important for coverage. So what has been the effectiveness of all of this? Is there anything that we can show for all this work? I can show you some numbers, a few numbers. There are currently more than about 2,500 facilities that are supported in various countries, 542 laboratories that are being supported, and many, many hundreds of thousands of laboratory tests that are being conducted. As you can see here, the large numbers of laboratory tests that are being conducted. The 32,000 people that have been provided with training, all cadres of healthcare workers, nurses, physicians, outreach workers, laboratorians, logisticians, administrators, the breadth of all the providers in the healthcare system. More than 6 million people have received HIV testing. through ICAP-supported programs. This is the foundation. HIV testing is the foundation of prevention, as well as the foundation for guiding people into care and treatment. Almost 3.5 million pregnant women have attended antenatal care and received HIV testing. This is a very important first step for their own health, as well as to prevent transmission to their babies. And then, as was mentioned earlier, more than 1.5 million patients have received HIV care through these programs. And more than 800,000 have started life-saving antiretroviral therapy. Have we been successful in this decentralization, in reaching equity, in reaching people where they are? You can see here, starting from 2006 to 2012, over time, this is the proportion of primary facilities, primary healthcare. Those are the smaller type of facilities where patients were enrolled for antiretroviral initiation. You can see the increase from about 10% to now almost half of the initiations are occurring at small facilities, which are usually in more remote areas. While you can see again, the secondary and tertiary facilities are decreasing over time. This is what you want in order to achieve coverage and to achieve equity. And if you look at urban versus rural, you see the same thing. Here, urban decreasing over time by almost half the facilities where antiretroviral therapy is initiated. And you can see increase in the rural areas where antiretroviral therapy is initiated. Most importantly has been the issue of the cascade. And what that's about quality. As you can see here, that the status of patients who initiated therapy is 81% overall in these countries that are on this slide here are continued on antiretroviral therapy. They have not been lost to antiretroviral care. You can see there's a smaller proportion that have been lost to follow-up and a smaller proportion that have been reported to have died. So this is our impact of our program as one piece of a much larger puzzle with so many people that have contributed to this global response. And what has been the impact? I think the impact can be seen nicely in this one slide from UNAIDS slide. With the scale-up of antiretroviral therapy, you can see here in the blue line, you can see the plateauing and the beginning of a decrease, the decrease that we're seeing in people living, in people dying from AIDS-related conditions. We're beginning to actually see the beginnings of even a reversal of some of the losses in life expectancy that I showed you in one of my first slides. Now, this has been very controversial, as many of you know. Some people have said that the HIV response is necessary, absolutely necessary, because of the magnitude of the epidemic on the communities, on these countries. But others, on the other hand, have said, no, you should not have done this. You should have focused simply on health system strengthening, without a focus on the HIV itself as a condition, without a targeted focus on HIV. This is the eternal dilemma of people, the controversy between vertical programs and what some people call horizontal programs. We believe in diagonal programs, programs that have a focus, but on the other hand, pay attention to health system strengthening components. We've actually written several papers with my colleagues that make this argument. Why reinvent the wheel, leverage the lessons learned from HIV to non-communicable disease, and many, many other papers making the argument that the investment in HIV, we have to be smart, we have to invest in the right way so we can garner some of the other benefits for the other health threats. And can HIV inform the response to other health threats? When you think about it, what are the barriers that we need to overcome? Whether you're talking about maternal health, you're talking about child health, you're talking about TB, diabetes, or HIV, there are many, many different barriers. Increasing demand for the services, very important. Increasing access, having insufficient healthcare workers, support for follow-up and adherence, infrastructure, equipment, program management, drug supply, referral linkages, community involvement. One has to satisfy all these elements in order to achieve our goals, whether it be related to maternal mortality or to HIV itself. So our approach has been that there are ways of thinking about this. You can have solely an HIV focus and think of nothing else, and in that way you will achieve HIV-related outcomes. On the other hand, there's the potential of HIV focus with what we call a spillover, meaning if you do it right, if you invest in HIV programs in the right way, with the right approach, with a health system focus, you can achieve substantial spillover. meaning you will have a positive, you may have a positive outcome for non-HIV conditions, maternal health, non-communicable diseases, tuberculosis, and others. Of course, there are others who believe, and we don't disagree with this, is that what you need to do is strengthen the health systems overall, and you're likely then to see advantageous outcomes for all of these conditions. The risk is by focusing on health systems alone without tying the investments to actual outcomes. The fear is that you dilute the efforts and you actually don't see what you anticipate in terms of desirable outcomes across the board. We've been very lucky here to have been able to contribute to very little data that are available to answer this question. This is a very seminal paper by Margaret Crook, who's right here at the Mailman School of Public Health and Health Policy and Management Department, and she published this very important article last year in which she actually looked at the effect of investment in antiretroviral therapy programs on deliveries, facility deliveries, which is very important by pregnant, non-HIV infected women in these same facilities. And what she found is that with increasing investment in antiretroviral therapy program, there was no decrease that was noted in deliveries by uninfected pregnant women. There also are other data that are accumulating. These are data from KwaZulu-Natal from South Africa that look at investments in prevention for mother-to-child transmission programs here or expansion of antiretroviral therapy programs here. And what's interesting to note is that with these investments in these programs, they were able to see a decrease in under 5 child mortality overall, not just for the HIV-infected children. So there's beginning to see some evidence of this positive spillover effect. But there's a great need for doing more research, and we're involved in trying to get more data, and others are working to try to get more data to answer this question as what is the optimal approach and what, if any, are positive or negative impacts of the investments in these programs. So let's move on to another issue, which is how can this inform the other health threats? This is a very busy figure, but it's a very informative figure. This is from a series of very important articles in The Lancet in last year, looking at disability-adjusted life years, DALIs, by cause, comparing these effects in 1990 and in 2010. On this side of these figures are essentially considered these the wealthy countries. For example, the United States, Western Europe, et cetera, et cetera. In the middle are Latin American countries, Central Asian countries or Asian countries, and to the right of the figure are African countries. I think you can notice from probably just by looking at the colors, which is an easy way of knowing it, there's a predominance of yellows on this side of the curve and purple and blue. And this really is the major issue in sub-Saharan Africa, which is, of course, HIV/AIDS, tuberculosis, diarrhea, lower respiratory infections and other infectious diseases, as well as neonatal conditions, maternal conditions, and so on, that are disproportionately affecting this continent. However, what's very interesting is globally we're seeing also a transition. You can see in these countries in the middle, here in the wealthy countries, cancer, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, of course, are predominant causes of disability. And you can see over time, there's here many of these countries in Asia, in particular Latin America and the Middle East, these countries are now also showing an increase in these non-communicable diseases. So the world is not very simple. There are different disease burdens in different parts of the world, and it's very important for us to shape our response based on these disease burdens. So let's look at Africa as an example, as I told you. And if I do the same thing and we look at reconfiguring the map, you can see the disproportionate impact of maternal mortality, infant mortality, child mortality, malaria, TB, et cetera. So this tells us that we should take the lessons learned to be able to respond to these enormous health threats. Have we been successful is the question. As you all know, the Millennium Development Goals, which are largely focused, of course, on Africa, have Millennium Development Goal 4, 5, and 6, which are the health-related ones, or the directly health-related ones, to reduce child mortality, improve maternal health, combat HIV, malaria, and other conditions. So we'll focus on how we've done in terms of these four MDGs. And you can see here from this figure that when you compare in green 1990 to pink 2010, again, in terms of African countries here, you can see there has been a decrease in the contribution of disabilities related to these MDGs in African countries, but the drop has not been substantial. You can see, on the other hand, if you look at Asian countries or the Middle East, there's much more a substantial decrease in terms of the burden of these conditions and the proportion of disability that's attributable to these three MDG goals. So we have a long way to go in order to be able to achieve the goals in some of the countries, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. We've made some progress in some of the other countries, but a lot remains to be done. So let's see how this can be done. I mean, we've showed you before the HIV cascade, which is relevant to HIV. Can we think of a similar cascade that we can focus on in order to achieve optimal outcomes for maternal health, maternal child health? And I tend to think of everything, really, these days in the cascade. You need first to early diagnosis of pregnancy is very important. You need to link the women who are pregnant to programs, antenatal care, engage them, counsel them, monitor them, and support them. You need to link them thereafter to delivery services where safe facility delivery is possible, emergency resuscitation and emergency services are available for the mother and child. And you have to think of this in a continuity fashion. How are you going to follow then in postnatal care these mothers and their babies? So thinking in the lesson learned from the HIV response is for us to think on the continuity of the care, rather than thinking of one piece of the puzzle, is that it is a continuous cascade, and we must take the lessons learned and try to optimize every part of this cascade if we are to achieve optimal outcomes. Now, if you look at what are the challenges in maternal child health, it's really very interesting. Of course, family planning is very important. So we need to, many women have unmet needs, the stigma, especially for young women who seek family contraception, lack of access to services. Similar to HIV, where I talked about delayed access to HIV care, we also have late entry into antenatal care for a variety of reasons. Lack of knowledge of the importance of antenatal care, perception that pregnancy is a normal thing and you really don't need to go to a clinic to be checked if you're pregnant. And then the quality of the service is very important again, limited access, barriers, poverty, distance, childcare, cultural issues, where often the father or the grandmother is the one who's making decision for the woman. The facility delivery and some of the challenges again with that. And finally, with postnatal care and some of the impediments as well. So thinking of the cascade and trying to think of ways to optimize the cascade, as many people have been doing, and particularly people here at the Mainland School, who have for decades been trying to tackle this cascade of maternal child health in order to minimize the deleterious outcomes for women and children. Now, in addition, of course, this is largely in countries in sub-Saharan Africa. As I told you, these are the prominent morbidity reasons for morbidity and mortality. The other challenge, of course, in many Asian countries, in Middle Eastern countries, and Latin American countries are non-communicable diseases. And what we've tried to do is to think about how can the HIV response inform programs for non-communicable diseases. And this is actually from a small pilot study that we did in Ethiopia, where we took HIV-related programmatic pieces, the peer education aspect of actually engaging, this is for a diabetes clinic, engaging people with diabetes to teach others about diabetes and to provide the care, educational materials, charting and scheduling tools, the concept of multidisciplinary teams. All of these elements of care were not there. Unfortunately, diabetes was not thought of as a chronic disease, similar to HIV as a chronic disease that requires a whole health system to be able to engage individuals in it. So just taking these elements and adapting them to diabetes with no extra funding, with nothing more, we were able to see in a diabetes clinic right adjacent to the HIV clinic actually a remarkable improvement in the quality of the services. You can see here over 6 months, while at the beginning only about 1% of the diabetes patient had a fundoscopy examination of their eyes, in 6 months that increased to 50%, foot examination from 3% to 80%, and then again, many of these are some of the clinical elements, but also we were also quite interested in also the follow-up and the ability of these individuals to be retained in care as it should be for anybody with a chronic communicable or non-communicable disease. The other lesson learned is what I called the gap between discovery and action. What's been very interesting in terms of doing HIV work for the past several decades is how we've been, many people who are in HIV have been able to telescope the distance, the time, the interval between discovery and action, whether it be implementation or scale-up. And there's some lessons learned that I think would be very informative as well. So let's look at a worst-case scenario, a case study of hepatitis B vaccine. So the hepatitis B vaccine, hepatitis B is a huge global health threat, by the way. It took 17 years from its first approval to reach 20% of the people, of patients, of people who need it. So it was approved first by the FDA in 1982, released 1986, but introduction price was very expensive, and therefore it never really was implemented or scaled up in many of the countries around the world. Adoption was slow due to perceived low cost effectiveness, limited uptake in poor countries, as well as, of course, limited data on the disease burden and strained childhood vaccination programs. Then in 1999, there was a creation of the Global Vaccine Initiative, which helped poor countries, again, increase their uptake of the vaccines. And the price went down when you started having pharmaceutical companies from developing countries actually producing the vaccine. This had a huge impact. And this is another lesson learned from HIV, is the involvement of generic companies brought the prices down to enable the global response to HIV, as well as, of course, the advocacy of people living with HIV. However, coverage remains very low. Only 15 out of 47 countries in sub-Saharan Africa have adopted this vaccine. So there is a gap between discovery to action. And I think our goal and our purpose, especially at the School of Public Health, is to find every way possible to decrease that gap between discovery to action. So you could have, for example, here on the y-axis is the intervention coverage from 0 to 100%. This is, of course, the theoretical figure. And you can see here the level of disease burden, again, from 0% to 100%. And on this x-axis is time. And with incremental coverage, increase incrementally in coverage, you can see in yellow, there'll be an incremental burden of the reduction in whatever condition you are targeting. On the other hand, if you have an acceleration in the coverage or scale-up, implementation, rapid implementation, you are more likely to see this accelerated decrease in disease burden. And this difference is very critical. If we can really take discoveries quickly to action, I think we could really gain tremendously in terms of decreasing the level of disease or disability burden. This has been done with HIV, and I'll give you one example. For example, with maternal antiretroviral therapy and transmission from mother to child, we know that using one drug, you can decrease transmission somewhat. By using two drugs, you can decrease it further, and by using triple drugs, you can decrease it to 1.2% transmission. This is from data from the United States. And the good news, and these are data from ICAP again, is that programs were very quickly able to adapt these data, this information, and were able to quickly go from one drug used for prevention of mother-to-child transmission to the use of multi-drugs for prevention of mother-to-child transmission. So it's an example of telescoping that period of time between discovery and action. So ultimately, I think what's very important and what's very critical, it's at the core of School of Public Health or people who are interested in public health, is the importance of focusing and continuing to focus on discovery, but at the same time to focus on implementation of these discoveries. And of course, very importantly, to achieve our goals, our public health goals, our ambitious public health goals, we have to scale them up. We have to scale up successful interventions. We owe it to the people. We can't leave the discovery sitting on a shelf and be just satisfied at this stage. We have to connect all of these back and forth. And I think very importantly, through implementation, new questions arise. Very often in implementing programs, those are where we get the best questions. The new areas for research emanate from the experience of implementation, and therefore the research can go on and discovery can happen. And similarly from scale-up, there are many different kinds of questions that need to be answered. And these questions need to, again, be taken into research in order to discover answers to those questions. So this is an iterative process. It's not a one-way street, and it should not be blocked at any part of this path. We have to continue from discovery to implementation, to scale up, and back again. And this is largely what ICAP's focus has been. It's been focused on the triad of service, providing programs, using the acronym of ACE with quality at the center, focusing on research for discovery to inform service, and of course, focusing on education and training. So I have some few conclusions for you. So success has been achieved in the scale-up of HIV programs over the past couple of decades, but largely over the past decade. The response to the HIV epidemic has required attention to all of the elements of the health system. No success can be achieved by focusing on one piece of the health system. It's doomed to fail. If these programs are to succeed, if these programs are to be durable and to stay there for the long term, they have to focus on the elements of the health system.